In part 1, we saw a TouchGFX demo. Now let's look at LVGL with the second setup, which is based on a Nucleo board and an external display. Between the two devices, we need to connect the power supply, the SPI, I2C, and a few GPIOs needed for control. To start testing, I decided to use homemade wire connections. However, I could have made a low-cost two-layer custom PCB to connect the board to the display. But you may know how it goes. You start small, then you think, why not include the microcontroller too? And then you end up designing a full-featured board. Anyway, so we start by creating a new project. To integrate the LVGL library, you can download the latest version from its GitHub repository and place it in your project drivers folder. Next, we take the lvconf template header file from the LVGL folder, rename it to lvconf, and place it alongside the LVGL folder. This configuration file lets you customize various settings, among which the color depth and the driver selection. We may exclude from the build unnecessary folder, for example, the test and demos folder. We also need to configure the touchscreen. For that, we take the two template files from the porting folder, rename them, and copy them to a new folder in our drivers directory. In those files, we need to implement the functions needed to interface with our specific touchscreen driver. On the microcontroller side, in summary, we need to configure the SPI peripheral to communicate with the LCD and the additional GPIOs needed to control the display. We need to rename each pin so that their names match the ones from the library. In this example, I also use FreeRTOS, but it is not a strict requirement for using LVGL. You may find the detailed instructions in the step-by-step guide in the documentation. I give you the link in the description. Once your configuration is complete, you can test your setup using the numerous code examples available within the LVGL library. However, while you can manually code your interface using these examples and the documentation, tools like EEZ Studio offer a more visual approach to UI design. It automatically generates most of the necessary files, which you can then import into your project, leaving just a few details to connect everything to your own code base. So let's now proceed to EEZ Studio and recreate the same interface we developed earlier with TouchGFX. We create a new project. We get a default main page containing a label. We change the screen's size. Note that it is highlighted in red because we need to change its dimension in the settings page. Then we remove the default label and create a new style for screens. We make a blue vertical gradient. In the Pages panel, we select the main screen, rename it Home, and apply the style we defined. We add a new page and name it Settings. Now we'll need icons for the buttons. I download them from the Google Materials library as PNG files and import them using the Bitmaps tab. We need two icons, one for each navigation button. Then we add a standard button. However, you can instead use a dedicated icon button. We change the background color to a kind of yellow and modify the dimensions. We remove the label and add an image. Buttons act as containers and you can place multiple widgets inside. For the image, we select the settings icon and we change the image recolor and recolor opacity properties. We copy the button, go to the settings page, paste it and change the image to the home icon. Then we add the label, change the color to white, the font size to 38, and change the text to settings. We copy and paste it on the home page. We change the text to 0, but we'll have to connect it to a variable later. We add a button and change the text to a plus sign. Here we go to the settings page to correct the page size. Next, we create three user actions. two for the page navigation and one to increment the counter. Then we connect them to the click events of the buttons. I didn't do it here, but as with TouchGFX, it is possible to define and use other fonts for the UI. Then we create a global variable named counter of type integer. In the label properties, we set the text to be the counter variable with a preview value of 0 and set the name to be LVGL counter. Here, the run button doesn't do anything because the actions are not defined. It is used when you enable the flow architecture from EEZ Studio. Now the user interface is finished and we can build the project to generate the source files. Next, we copy the UI folder into our project core folder. Be careful if you link files directly from the build folder that the code you add or modify may get deleted if you rebuild the UI files. So, in the IDE, we need to add the source code for the actions and the variables as is indicated by the tips windows in EEZ Studio. For that, you right-click the UI folder, create two new source files called actions.c and vars.c and write the necessary code as shown here. In the UI.c file, you may also modify the default transition type for your startup screen. Before we test the result, I am also showing you, for reference, the code for the touch interface. Here, it is initialized in the FreeRTOS main task. The functions make the communications over the I2C bus and interpret the touchpoint coordinates. The interrupt needs to be enabled in the configuration window. Then, the events are managed in a callback function defined in the main file. Once all this is done, we can compile and upload the firmware to the test board. And we see that the application behaves as we expected. However, as you watch the result, bear in mind what I said earlier. This demo has not been optimized and it is not intended to be a comparison with the other board. Although the hardware acceleration for this microcontroller is now available in the new version 9.3 of LVGL, it was not implemented here. So that's it for today. Thank you for watching and see you next time.